person. In fact, in various places in the Bhagavatam, there are descriptions of meditation upon the super soul. Initially, one meditates upon the soles of the feet of the super soul. One observes his toenails, which are brilliantly radiating transcendental light. One gradually works one's way up the bodily form of the super soul until finally reaching his smiling face. So this meditation is described. So it is understood that the super soul is personal. Now, of course, if it is understood that the super soul is the expansion of Shiradakasha Vishnu, who is the expansion ultimately of Mahavishnu, and then ultimately of Krishna, then that would lead to the conception, well, one could still say that they regarded Krishna as being a Vishnu expansion. That would be a possible interpretation here. Certainly the super soul is definitely understood to be personal. It's interesting to consider the concept of the Supreme being all-pervading, or dwelling everywhere. In the case of Brahman, in a naive way, it's fairly easy to imagine this. Because if you think of Brahman as some kind of impersonal light, then you can think of that light spreading everywhere, just as you can imagine sunlight spreading everywhere in space. Of course, that concept is not quite appropriate if you consider the idea that Brahman is one. Because if light is spreading everywhere in space, then in different areas of space you have different rays of light. So that would seem to indicate duality. Certainly the scientists think of sunlight, for example, as being made of little particles called photons. And in fact, the number of particles in sunlight coming out of the sun in 1 second would be a huge number. I suppose that's calculated. But it would be a gigantic number. So then if you think of Brahman as being like sunlight, then you're ascribing a tremendous amount of duality to Brahman. Because you're saying Brahman is made up of billions and billions and billions of particles that are in different places. And in that sense, it's all pervading because the different particles are going to different locations. But that doesn't seem to fit in with the idea of oneness. So, of course, also, the point should be made that according to the Vaishnava understanding, Brahman also has variegated features. For example, it's understood that spirit souls can enter into Brahman, at least temporarily, and undergo the Brahma Sayuja stage of liberation. However, it is understood that those spirit souls retain their individuality. So this means that if there are many individual jiva souls within the Brahma Jyoti, which means that there's variety then within the Brahma Jyoti. In fact, Srila Prabhupada has given the example that of green parrots flying into a green tree. And this is an example you can see realized in Vrindavan, because there are parrots there whose feathers, the coloration of whose feathers precisely matches the leaves of the trees. And you can actually see a parrot fly into a tree and it seems to disappear because it's now camouflaged by the leaves that have the same color as its feathers. But then the same parrot can come flying out again, which means that within the tree, you didn't actually have oneness in the sense that there's only one unique entity there. So that if something goes into the tree, it merges into that oneness and loses its individuality. But actually the bird retained its individuality and came flying out again. So Brahman, according to the Vaishnava understanding, does have variegated form. The concept of Brahman as impersonal and pervading space nonetheless does fit in with the sort of intuitive conception that many people have of God, certainly in the West, this is also a very common conception. For example, I recall that when I used to go to church, I thought that God was something like the air. It must be floating everywhere. So, not a very inspiring concept, ultimately. So, the all-pervading character of Paramatma poses even a more difficult conceptual problem than that of Brahman, because you can ask, how can one individual person who has arms and legs and a head and so forth be all-pervading? So, one concept is that there are, so to speak, many Paramatmas. In other words, it is said that Paramatma is in the heart of every living being. So you can imagine in the heart of each living being, there is an individual form of Paramatma. So that would mean that there are many of them. But the Bhagavad Gita specifically says that that's not correct. It states that the supersoul appears to be divided into many, but actually be situated as one. So the actual situation is that there's one supersoul who is simultaneously present at every location in space. And another way to look at it is to say that all locations in space are where supersoul is. So that from the point of view of supersoul, there's direct access to every position within space. So this in turn leads to the some interesting consequences. There's a mathematical subject called topology, which is the study of space. What happened is that the mathematicians were making an effort to understand what space is in essence. So they had certain ideas of space that were traditional. For example, the ideas you find in Euclidean geometry, which was coming down from the Greeks. And for many years, people thought that Euclidean geometry was the last word in understanding what space is. But then they invented non-Euclidean geometry. And they began to create all kinds of different geometries with different properties. And so they began to ask, well, what is the essence of space? So they developed ideas of higher dimensional spaces and spaces to which the concept of dimension doesn't even apply, and so on. So this idea that all points in space are right next to each other is something that does appear in some studies of topology. You could have a space like that, in which every point is in the direct neighborhood of every other point. So it would seem that at the ultimate level of reality, space is like that, in the sense that Krishna is present at every location of space simultaneously, which in turn means that every location is present where Krishna is. Now this has some direct consequences. For example, there's the story given by Lord Chaitanya of how Brahma visited Krishna in Dwarka. And this directly illustrates this idea. The story goes that Brahma wanted to visit Krishna, so he went to Dwarka, and he was waiting in a sort of antechamber to see Krishna. And a lot of people were going in to see Krishna, so finally the secretary came out and asked Brahma who he was. And he said, well, I'm Brahma. Please tell Krishna that Brahma has come to see him. So the secretary came out a few moments later and said, Krishna would like to know which Brahma has come to see him. So Rama said that, well, my goodness, is there any Brahma in this universe apart from me? So he said, tell Krishna that the Brahma who has four heads and is the father of the four Kumaras would like to see him. So in due course, he was ushered in to see Krishna, and he asked Krishna what he meant by asking which Brahma came to see him. And so Krishna responded by summoning millions of Brahmas, unlimited billions of Brahmas. So all of these Brahmas came into the room where Krishna was, and they were all offering their obeisances at the lotus feet of Krishna, touching their golden helmets to the floor in front of Krishna's feet. So our Brahma was able to see all of that. And it is said that each helmet as it touched the floor made a little twink. So you can imagine billions of twinks sounding simultaneously. So it made a tremendous sound. It's described, though, that our Brahma was able to see all of these other Brahmas coming to visit Krishna. But each of the other Brahmas saw only himself and Krishna in the room. Also, Krishna asked each of the Brahmas, how are things going in your universe? And each Brahma said to Krishna, well, now that you've incarnated within my universe, there's no problem from the demons. Everything is happening very nicely. So, the indication is that each Brahma was still within his own universe, and he was visiting Krishna in Dwarka, within his universe. And so this would indicate then that Krishna was in one room, which was simultaneously in all of these different universes. And so he could just summon Brahma within each universe. And normally, it seems Krishna is, of course, completely in control of the connectivity of space, that is, how different parts of space connect to other parts of space. So he arranged it so that each of the Brahmas, except ours, was in his own individual space when he came to meet Krishna. But our Brahma had access to all of them. It's similar to the situation where Arjuna was shown the universal form, and Krishna enabled Arjuna, even though he was standing in one place, to simultaneously see manifestations all over the universe, including many things which had never been seen before, at least in that part of the universe. So this indicates the higher dimensional nature of Krishna. Of course, also it's described that these other Brahmas had various numbers of heads, which seem to go in powers of two, like 4, 16, 32, and so forth. And there's a painting by Jadarani in the teachings of Lord Chaitanya, in which he tried to portray Brahmas with these various numbers of heads. And they came out looking somewhat like Christmas trees, with the heads as ornaments. It struck me that probably these were higher dimensional Brahmas. In other words, our Brahma has four heads because he's accustomed to operating in three-dimensional space. So he has four heads for looking north, south, east, and west. So that's appropriate in this continuum. But if a Brahma has, let us say, 32 heads, how are they situated? But if you have higher dimensional space, there could be extra dimensions for each of those heads to be looking in. And so then you can say, well, what happens if Brahma has billions of heads? So, in addition to this, so this story of the many Brahmas meeting Krishna is consistent with this idea that Krishna is present everywhere. And in fact, the one Krishna who was responding to Brahma was present in all these different universes at one time. So it would appear that there are additional practical consequences of this. One has to do with transportation. In the 11th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is described that the different siddhis, especially including the eight primary siddhis, are natural potencies of Krishna, and that jivas are enabled to obtain these siddhis in a minor degree by Krishna's grace. So, the all-pervading nature of Krishna corresponds to the siddhi by which it is possible to go to another place without crossing the space in between. And that would seem to make sense, because if Krishna gives a small part of his potency of being present at every point in space simultaneously, then that would mean that the individual should be able to go to another point in space in a direct way. So, it's stated in the verse for today, that the completely surrendered soul cannot be deviated by the words of persons bewildered by the illusory energy. So Srila Prabhupada refers here in the purport to people of modern-day mundane education who are infected by the mentality of atheism. So it is interesting to see how the inner psychology of an individual influences what they will perceive to be true. So a person who is by nature surrendered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead is able to actually understand Krishna as he is from the words in the Shastras. And such persons, such as Uddhava, were able to directly understand who Krishna was when he appeared before them. But other individuals who were also seeing Krishna right in front of their very eyes were not able to understand what he was. And depending on their inner psychology, they were able to arrive at different conclusions about Krishna. And all of these conclusions could be supported by different kinds of evidence. So the Yadus were seeing Krishna as a manifestation of the One Supreme that is all-pervading. Many of the demigods who saw Krishna regarded him as the topmost creation of Brahma. So they thought that his body was a material creation. Other individuals thought that Krishna was a being who could be defeated in battle or slain. So they thought that he was a person of limited power. So there were many different understandings of Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada refers to the understanding of the mundane personalities. One feature is that the mundane personalities take advantage of Krishna's pastimes, which he performed when leaving the world. Is that Madhusalya Lila? Is the term for that? So Krishna, of course, arranges for persons in different stages of consciousness to be able to maintain different points of view. It's not that the individual persons have to do this entirely on their own power. So, in particular, when Krishna left the material world, he conveniently left a dead body behind, thus making it appear that he was a mortal man. In fact, this body died because of being shot by a hunter. Of course, the circumstances here are a little bit suspicious, because what happened was the hunter shot Krishna in the foot with an arrow, and Krishna died. And this is curious, because Krishna had engaged in quite a few battles, and he had the pastime of being shot by many arrows, in fact. For example, with Bhishma, he engaged in this pastime. This was a loving exchange and a unique rasa that Krishna had with Bhishma Dev, a chivalrous rasa. So Bhishma Dev was shooting Krishna with arrows, and he was actually bleeding and so forth. However, the arrows didn't affect him. Because if Krishna wants to bleed due to being shot with arrows, then he can do that. But his transcendental form is still perfectly unaffected by all material conditions. It's merely a pastime. So the evidence was there that Krishna was doing things like that. Of course, then if he wanted to fight, he could also do that. There are the occasions in which Krishna and Balaram wiped out the armies of Jarasandha single-handedly. They just let loose a rather dense cloud of arrows and totally wiped out vast armies. And they were not affected in the slightest degree by the weapons of the enemy soldiers. So then, after all that, Krishna is shot in the foot with an arrow, and he died. So, this is a, Srila Prabhupada has explained that this is a pastime which was designed basically to give an excuse to the atheists so that they could be atheists. So Krishna provides for that. Krishna also provides the different theories of the atheists. scientists are very proud of creating many different theories, but one thing that they don't realize is that actually the Supersoul within their hearts is providing them with the intelligence by which these theories are created. So Krishna actually dictates atheistic theories to those who want to think in that way. So, let's see. Srila Prabhupada makes some additional points here about the statement in Bhagavad Gita that Krishna is not affected by karma or by work in the material world. So the argument was that Krishna has engaged in sinful activity by engaging in all kinds of Machiavellian political maneuvers intended to wipe out, for example, the sons of Dhritarashtra. So this was considered to be greatly sinful activity by the persons with atheistic inclinations. And so they said as a result of this, Krishna was killed because of his sins. However, the Bhagavad Gita says that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is not affected by actions performed within the material world. So the Supreme Lord, in fact, is in a completely different situation from that of the conditioned living being. The conditioned living beings are placed in a situation of being able to try to exploit the material energy, and as a result of their activities in exploiting that energy, they're held responsible. So then there's a karmic reaction to those activities. Now, it is a fact that Krishna, as Supersoul, is delivering the karmic reactions to the different living beings. So in that sense, he's the ultimate doer. And the individual living being is, in fact, not the doer. And that's also stated in the Bhagavad Gita. But Krishna does not take responsibility for these actions, because, in fact, the individual living being is desiring to perform these actions, and Krishna is merely facilitating the living being by providing the material situation in which these actions can be taken can take place. So therefore, the karma has to be accepted by the individual soul. So, these are a number of points that were made in connection with this verse. Are there any questions or comments? Yeah?
Your analysis of that time and space at any point connects to another point, and this is an understanding of how Krishna soul can be in one place and everywhere. Mm-hmm. In Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada gives an example that seems to uphold that, in which he said, if you're walking, the sun's directly overhead and moon. If you travel 5,000 miles, the sun is still directly overhead and moon, so even though you've gone to different places, still directly next to the sun in that sense.
Yeah.
But then sometimes you hear another analogy of the super soul, like the reflection of the sun in any water pocket.
Mm-hmm.
So that would follow the same conception of space.
Yes, well, if you think that the super soul that is really there in your heart is analogous to a reflection, then that that would seem to be different from the actual understanding that the super soul is literally present within your heart. So the water pot analogy, of course, if you look at it carefully, it's really the same as the analogy of seeing the sun beating down on you, because you could still argue that when you walk to a different place, after all, different rays of the sun are striking you. And the sun looks the same because it's so big and so far away that it doesn't seem to change position much when you walk. Just like if you're walking along, you'll see the trees nearby are moving past fairly quickly, but say a forest in the distance is moving very slowly, and that's because it's further away. So when you move a given distance, the angle by which things move is smaller. So if the sun is very far away, then the angle by which the sun moves when you walk a few miles is so tiny that you couldn't possibly detect that. So, but nonetheless, looking at it logically, you have to say that different sun's rays are striking you say, in one location than in another. So in that sense, it is a different sun, or a different manifestation of the sun that you are perceiving. So what that amounts to is that the analogy is imperfect. And of course, this is true generally of analogies. An analogy is something that in which there are certain points which illustrate an underlying conception. But it's not true that all of the points of the analogy are going to apply. So that would be true of both the example of the sun and the example of the sun reflected in the water pot. Anything else? Yeah.
We think that some of the demigods had the idea that Krishna was the topmost creation of Brahma.
Yeah.
Meaning that he had a material body, or that, and that he had nothing to do with the Supreme Brahman, just a jiva in a material body, or that the Brahman had taken the body, and this is the topmost kind of body that the Brahman got up.
Well, as a statement I've seen, there's one that comes up just a few verses from here. For example, text 13 is coming up. Let's see. All the demigods from the upper, lower, and middle universal planetary systems assembled at the altar of the Rajasriya sacrifice performed by Maharaj Yudhisthira. After seeing the beautiful bodily features of Lord Krishna, they all contemplated that he was the ultimate dexterous creation of Brahma, the creator of human beings. So that would seem to indicate that Brahma used his dexterity to perform that creation. And it refers to him as the creator of human beings. So that would seem to indicate that these demigods were thinking that Krishna had the ultimate creation made by Brahma, as opposed to Krishna having a body which corresponded to the kind of body that Brahma would create if he was doing his best.
There's a branch of Rayabad philosophy that says that when Brahman descends, it takes a body made of a vidya, different than the bodies of all of us who are covered with avidya. But ultimately, it's all illusion. Anyway, but here it seems that the demigods are either mudhas or lower than impersonalists because they think it's just, you know, something created by Brahman. It seems inconsistent with our picture of the demigods as being very devotees.
Well, of course, I believe there is also a reference to the gopis. Weren't they criticizing Brahman? Oh, no, that doesn't fit. Sorry about that one. But let's see. Well, let's see what it said in the Sanskrit here. The word for dexterity is there. And then the word for mankind is there. In fact, our boss, recent mankind, should...
Evolutionary theory can fly.
Well, let's see. Yeah, the Kam, the surpassed, and the Dasu of the creator, Rama, our Bach, recent mankind, Shrital, in the material world, partial on dexterity. Thus they contemplated. So, it seems to be saying that they were really thinking Krishna, his body was created by Rama, which, that's even different from thinking that Rama manifested as Krishna. So, there's a mathematical subject called topology, which is the study of space. What happened is that the mathematicians were making an effort to understand what space is in essence. So they had certain ideas of space that were traditional. For example, the ideas you find in Euclidean geometry, which was coming down from the Greeks. And for many years, people thought that Euclidean geometry was the last word in understanding what space is. But then they invented non-Euclidean geometry. And they began to create all kinds of different geometries with different properties. And so they began to ask, well, what is the essence of space? So they developed ideas of higher dimensional spaces and spaces to which the concept of dimension doesn't even apply, and so on. So this idea that all points in space are right next to each other is something that does appear in some studies of topology. You could have a space like that, in which every point is in the direct neighborhood of every other point. So it would seem that at the ultimate level of reality, space is like that, in the sense that Krishna is present at every location of space simultaneously, which in turn means that every location is present where Krishna is. Now this has some direct consequences. For example, there's the story given by Lord Chaitanya of how Brahma visited Krishna in Dwarka. And this directly illustrates this idea. The story goes that Brahma wanted to visit Krishna, so he went to Dwarka, and he was waiting in a sort of antechamber to see Krishna. And a lot of people were going in to see Krishna, so finally the secretary came out and asked Brahma who he was. And he said, I'm Brahma. Please tell Krishna that Brahma has come to see him. So the secretary came out a few moments later and said, Krishna would like to know which is only one unique entity there. So that if something goes into the tree, it merges into that oneness and loses its individuality. But actually the bird retained its individuality and came flying out again. So Brahman, according to the Vaishnava understanding, does have variegated form. The concept of Brahman as impersonal and pervading space nonetheless does fit in with the sort of intuitive conception that many people have of God. Certainly in the West, this is also a very common conception. For example, I recall that when I used to go to church, I thought that God was something like the air. It must be floating everywhere. So, not a very inspiring concept, ultimately. So, the all-pervading character of Paramatma poses even a more difficult conceptual problem than that of Brahman, because you can ask, how can one individual person who has arms and legs and a head and so forth be all-pervading? So one concept is that there are, so to speak, many Paramatmas. In other words, it is said that Paramatma is in the heart of every living being. So you can imagine in the heart of each living being there is an individual form of Paramatma. So that would mean that there are many of them. But the Bhagavad Gita specifically says that that's not correct. It states that the supersoul appears to be divided into many, but actually is situated as one. So the actual situation is that there's one supersoul who is simultaneously present at every location in space. And another way to look at it is to say that all locations in space are where supersoul is. So that from the point of view of supersoul, there's direct access to every position within space. So this in turn leads to the some interesting consequences. For areas of space, you have different rays of light. So that would seem to indicate duality. Certainly the scientists think of sunlight, for example, as being made of little particles called photons. And in fact, the number of particles in sunlight coming out of the sun in 1 second would be a huge number. I suppose that's calculated. But it would be a gigantic number. So then if you think of Brahman as being like sunlight, then you're ascribing a tremendous amount of duality to Brahman. As you're saying, Brahman is made up of billions and billions and billions of particles that are in different places. And in that sense, it's all pervading because the different particles are going to different locations. But that doesn't seem to fit in with the idea of oneness. So, of course, also, the point should be made that according to the Vaishnava understanding, Brahman also has variegated features. For example, it's understood that spirit souls can enter into Brahman, at least temporarily, and undergo the Brahma Sayuja stage of liberation. However, it is understood that those spirit souls retain their individuality. So this means that if there are many individual jiva souls within the Brahma Jyoti, which means that there's variety then within the Brahma Jyoti. In fact, Srila Prabhupada has given the example that a green parrot flying into a green tree, and this is an example you can see realized in Vrindavan, because there are parrots there whose feathers, the coloration of whose feathers precisely matches the leaves of the trees. And you can actually see a parrot fly into a tree and it seems to disappear because it's now camouflaged by the leaves that have the same color as its feathers. But then the same parrot can come flying out again, which means that within the tree, you didn't actually have oneness in the sense that the Brahma has come to see it. So Rama said that, well, my goodness, is there any Brahma in this universe apart from me? So he said, tell Krishna that the Brahma who has four heads and is the father of the four Kumaras would like to see him. So in due course, he was ushered in to see Krishna, and he asked Krishna what he meant by asking which Brahma came to see him. And so Krishna responded by summoning millions of Brahmas, unlimited billions of Brahmas. So all of these Brahmas came into the room where Krishna was, and they were all offering their obeisances at the lotus feet of Krishna, touching their golden helmets to the floor in front of Krishna's feet. So our Brahma was able to see all of that. And it is said that each helmet as it touched the floor made a little clink. So you can imagine billions of clinks sounding simultaneously. So it made a tremendous sound. It's described, though, that our Brahma was able to see all of these other Brahmas coming to visit Krishna. But each of the other Brahmas saw only himself and Krishna in the room. Also, Krishna asked each of the Brahmas, how are things going in your universe? And each Brahma said to Krishna, well, now that you've incarnated within my universe, there's no problem from the demons. Everything is happening very nicely. So the indication is that each Brahma was still within his own universe, and he was visiting Krishna in Dwarka, within his universe. And so this would indicate then that Krishna was in one room, which was simultaneously in all of these different universes. And so he could just summon Brahma within each universe. And normally, it seems Krishna is, of course, completely in control of the connectivity of space, that is, how different parts of space connect to other parts of space. So he arranged it so that places in the Bhagavatam, there are descriptions of meditation upon the super soul. Initially, one meditates upon the soles of the feet of the super soul. One observes his toenails, which are brilliantly radiating transcendental light. One gradually works one's way up the bodily form of the super soul until finally reaching his smiling face. So this meditation is described. So it is understood that the super soul is personal. Now, of course, if it is understood that the super soul is the expansion of Shiva Dakshina Vishnu, who is the expansion ultimately of Mahavishnu and then ultimately of Krishna, then that would lead to the conception, well, one could still say that they regarded Krishna as being a Vishnu expansion. That would be a possible interpretation here. Certainly the Supersoul is definitely understood to be personal. It's interesting to consider the concept of the Supreme being all-pervading, or dwelling everywhere. In the case of Brahman, in a naive way, it's fairly easy to imagine this. Because if you think of Brahman as some kind of impersonal light, then you can think of that light spreading everywhere, just as you can imagine sunlight spreading everywhere in space. Of course, that concept is not quite appropriate if you consider the idea that Brahman is one, because if light is spreading everywhere in space, then in different